in beiden Bereichen, in den Wissenschaften wie in der Kunst, ganz Unterschiedliches und generieren doch beide Erkenntnisse. Doch welche Erkenntnisse sind das und was passiert, wenn man diese beiden Bereiche miteinander in Verbindung bringt? Diesen Fragen gehen wir in unserer Serie Fotografie und Wissenschaft im Dialog nach. Heute heiße ich Sie ganz herzlich willkommen zu der Auftaktveranstaltung Sound and Vision, Poptheorie, mit Anton Corbijn und Robin Curtis. Thank you for being here. Henry Kiesow wird Sie gleich vorstellen. Entwickelt haben wir die Reihe gemeinsam, das Institut für Europäische Kunstgeschichte mit Professor Henry Kiesow und Dr. Liane Wilhelmus, wir sind beide da drüben, dann vom DAI war das Jakob Köllhofer und Jutta Wagner, sie wird gleich kurz nach mir sprechen, und als Projektleiterin Trixi Schmidtchen von der Biennale für Aktuelle Fotografie und ich ebenfalls von der Biennale für Aktuelle Fotografie, die am 28. Februar in der Kunsthalle Mannheim eröffnet. Und da möchte ich jetzt gleich die Gelegenheit nutzen, Sie auch dazu einzuladen. Und Informationen finden Sie draußen auf den Tischen mit den Flyern. Wir haben an insgesamt 8 Abenden je einen Künstler und einen Wissenschaftler eingeladen. Und es ist geplant, dass es ein offenes Gespräch wird, wo der Künstler jeweils sein Werk vorstellt oder eine Werkgruppe und der Wissenschaftler aus seiner jeweiligen Perspektive darauf antwortet. Wir schauen uns mit Herlinde Kölbel und Christian Schicher Bilder von mächtigen Politikerinnen an. Mit Tim Rautert und Horst Bredekamp wird es um die Grundlagen der Fotografie gehen. Mit Benjamin Samuel und Achim Wambach sehen wir, wie bunt der Börsencrash leuchtet. Mit Simon Starling und Joachim Wamsgans schauen wir, welcher Weg die Venus beschreibt. Mit Andrea Diefenbach und Hans Jäger, wie sich das HIV-Virus zeigt. Mit dem Künstlerduo Broomberg und Shannarin und Grischka Petri untersuchen wir Kriegs- und Propagandadarstellungen. Und Armin Linke und Estelle Blaschke sprechen zusammen mit Sabine Süßtrunk über Fotografie als Rohstoff der Zukunft. Es ist ein Experiment. Wir sind sehr gespannt, wie die Gespräche sich entwickeln und was die Verschränkung von Kunst und Wissenschaft für Erkenntnisse zutage fördert. Alle weiteren Veranstaltungen werden im Psychologischen Institut hier in Heidelberg stattfinden, das ist in der Hauptstraße. Dazu möchten wir Sie natürlich auch einladen. Und die nächste ist gleich nächste Woche, am 23. Januar, und trägt den Titel Spuren der Macht. Unser Dank gilt unseren Förderern, der Alfred Krupp von Bohlen und Halber Stiftung, der Friedrich Stiftung und der Stadt Heidelberg. Und diese, wie auch alle weiteren Veranstaltungen, werden aufgezeichnet, deswegen steht dort die Kamera, und Sie können sie dann auf dem Kanal der Universität später anschauen. Und falls Sie mal eine live verpassen sollten, dann haben Sie eben die Gelegenheit. Und jetzt übergebe ich an meine Kollegin Jutta Wagner. Vielen Dank fürs Kommen.
Meine Damen und Herren, auch von Seiten des DAI ein ganz herzliches Willkommen heute Abend. Wir freuen uns sehr, dass wir in dieser wunderbaren Reihe kooperieren. Und Sie haben alle sicherlich das Programm schon gesehen. Wir werden in den nächsten Wochen alle unter einem wahren Sternenhimmel von großartigen Künstlern und Wissenschaftlerinnen sein. Es ist eine große Freude. In den Dialog zu treten, im Dialog zu sein, ist ein Kernanliegen des DAI, das sich tatsächlich durch unser ganzes Programm zieht. Künste, Wissenschaften, unterschiedliche Disziplinen miteinander in Berührung zu bringen, ist uns sehr wichtig und natürlich immer auch die Menschen. Zum Dialog gehört immer auch die Fähigkeit, Grenzen zu überschreiten oder zumindest den Blick über Grenzen zu erheben. Damit geht man vom eigenen, vom Bekannten einen Schritt weit weg und beschäftigt sich intensiv mit dem anderen, in Anführungszeichen sage ich das, mit dem noch nicht Bekannten. Man sieht dann irgendwann auch das eigene, das vermeintlich Bekannte, mit anderen Augen und hinterfragt Sehgewohnheiten. Mit den Sehgewohnheiten auch Denkgewohnheiten, Sehmuster. Und man lernt über sich und über die Welt. Was uns an dieser Reihe auch sehr reizt, ist, dass sie im Grunde auch ein Plädoyer für die Genauigkeit des Sehens und für die Wahrnehmung ist. Jede einzelne Veranstaltung fordert es von Neuem ein. Sie haben gerade die Themen gehört, die Jasmin Meinecke vorgestellt hat. Wir erleben ja heutzutage eine wahre Inflation der Bilder. Und wie sehr ist man verführt, einfach so über die Menge der Bilder hinweg zu fliegen, zu wischen, auch mal so mit dem Smartphone, und letztlich werden sie dabei immer verwischt. Hier bei diesen Veranstaltungen erleben wir eine Konzentration auf das einzelne Bild. Wir stärken damit das genaue Hinsehen, das feinsinnige Hinhören auch. Und wir geben der Vorstellungskraft wieder Raum, die oft überfüttert wird. Und hier hat sie Raum, wieder stark zu werden. So gesehen ist die gesamte Reihe auch eine herzliche Einladung und ein Appell zum Augen auf und Ohren auf. Und ich freue mich sehr auf viele bereichernde und erhellende Momente, die wir sicherlich gemeinsam erleben werden. Vielen Dank und viel Vergnügen auch.
Ich werde jetzt ein bisschen länger hier stehen, nicht weil ich Sie zutexten möchte, sondern weil mir zwei Funktionen zukommen. Zum einen möchte ich Sie auch begrüßen und zum anderen bin ich sozusagen der Master of Ceremonies für heute Abend, der MC. Das heißt, ich moderiere diese heutige Veranstaltung und möchte damit beginnen. Sie wissen vielleicht alle, dass heute das Wissenschaftsjahr 2020 beginnt. Insofern sind wir genau perfekt getimt mit unserer Veranstaltung, in der es ja um Fotografie und Wissenschaft geht. Das heißt, genau um diesen Austausch zwischen auf der einen Seite, wenn Sie so wollen, praktischer Kunst und auf der anderen Seite eben dem Nachdenken über Kunst. Und ich möchte an dieser Stelle auch noch einmal unseren Partnerinnen und Partnern ganz herzlich danken. Frau Meinecke hat es gerade auch schon getan, aber ich möchte einmal eben mich bei Frau Jasmin Meinecke, bei Frau Trixi Schmidtchen und auch bei Herrn Christoph Blas dafür bedanken von der Biennale für diese Kooperation. Ebenso Herrn Jakob Kollhöfer und Frau Jutta Wagner auch für die Kooperation. Und ich bedanke mich an dieser Stelle auch bei Frau Johanna Baumgärtel und Herrn Kevin Licht vom SFB Materiale Textkulturen, die die Aufzeichnung heute Abend möglich machen. Sie haben es schon gehört, das wird anschließend auf dem Universitätskanal, ist dann auch auf YouTube einsehbar verfügbar. Zu meiner Aufgabe gehört es auch, Ihnen kurz etwas über den Ablauf des heutigen Abends zu sagen. Wir werden jetzt im Anschluss an die Grußworte, werde ich unsere beiden Gesprächspartner für heute Abend kurz vorstellen. Danach werden die beiden ein ca. 40- bis 45-minütiges Gespräch führen. Und dann im Anschluss werden wir zum Ende der Veranstaltung das Ganze auch noch hin auf das Publikum öffnen. Das heißt, Sie haben dann auch noch einmal zum Schluss die Möglichkeit, Fragen zu stellen. Dazu werden wir ein Standmikrofon hier aufstellen, zu dem Sie dann bitte nach vorne kommen. Das hat einfach den Vorteil, wenn wir ein Mikro umreichen, dann dauert es immer sehr lange, bis das bei der betreffenden Person angekommen ist. Und dann ist es anschließend manchmal auch schwierig, an dieses Mikro wieder ranzukommen. Sie müssen sich keine Sorgen machen, wenn Sie hier jetzt in das Mikrofon reinsprechen, weil das, was Sie hier in das Mikrofon sprechen, wird nicht aufgezeichnet, sondern wir werden die Fragen dann verschriftlichen und dann auf dem YouTube-Kanal einstellen. Das müssen wir aus Persönlichkeitsrechten machen, weil nicht jeder, der in dieses Mikro spricht, auch möchte, dass das dann anschließend auf YouTube verfügbar ist, obwohl das natürlich Ihre Chance wäre, auch mal auf YouTube zu sein. Im Anschluss an die Veranstaltung gibt es dann unten einen Umtrunk, zu dem Sie ganz herzlich eingeladen sind. Insofern also haben Sie beides. Sie haben jetzt zunächst einmal ein Gespräch und im Anschluss können Sie dann, auch wenn Sie selber vielleicht dabei nicht so viel gesprochen haben, Ihre trockenen Kehlen dann anschließend also bei etwas Getränken, alkoholischen wie nicht alkoholischen, wieder erfrischen. Damit komme ich zur Vorstellung und Ladies first, Robin Curtis. Sie studierte Cinema Studies and German Languages and Literature an der University of Toronto. Sie ist auch in Toronto geboren und sie ist dann aber eben nach Deutschland gekommen, hat dann nämlich an der Freien Universität Berlin Theaterwissenschaft und Nordamerika-Studien studiert, hat dann ihr Magisterstudium abgeschlossen mit einer Arbeit zum Thema Film und Gedächtnis. Lakune der Geschichten, der Geschichte. Also da geht es eben um Gedächtnislücken sozusagen. Sie sehen da schon von vornherein das Interesse an den Medien, am Film. Sie war dann wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin an der Abteilung der Hochschule für Film und Fernsehen Potsdam-Babelsberg, wie sie dann Mitarbeiterin in einem Sonderforschungsbereich Kulturen des Performativen an der Freien Universität wurde. Sie hat dann 2003 in Berlin promoviert, und zwar bei Gertrud Koch, zum Thema Situating the Self, Visual Experience and Anxiety in the German Non-Fictional Autobiographical Film. Sie war dann Stipendiatin und schließlich dann von 2012 bis 2017 Professorin für Theorie und Geschichte der audiovisuellen Medien an der Heinrich-Heine-Universität Düsseldorf. Sie hat dann habilitiert zum Thema filmische Immersion und ist seit 2017 Inhaberin des Lehrstuhls für Medienkulturwissenschaft an der Albert-Ludwigs-Universität Freiburg. Sie ist zugleich Direktorin des Zentrums für populäre Kultur und Musik der Universität Freiburg, einem 2014 gegründeten Institut, das hervorgegangen ist aus einer Institution, die 1914 von John Mayer gegründet wurde, nämlich das Deutsche Volksliedarchiv. Das dient der Erforschung populärer Musikkulturen in verschiedenen historischen und gegenwärtigen Ausprägungen. Und eben an dieser Nachfolgeinstitution ist Frau Körtis jetzt Direktorin. Und das war natürlich auch sozusagen, abgesehen mal davon, dass wir uns persönlich kennen und ich eben wusste, dass sie zu diesem Thema, zu diesem Gespräch auch entsprechend gut eben fundiert vorbereitet ist, das war natürlich auch so unser Aufhänger, Frau Körtis hier einzuladen. Anton Corbijn muss ich eigentlich fast nicht vorstellen. Ich werde deshalb aus zwei Gründen, zum einen, weil Sie ihn wahrscheinlich alle kennen, zum anderen, Sie sehen schon, er wird gleich durch eine kurze Präsentation uns dann eben auch noch einmal in sein Oeuvre einstimmen. Ich will aber dennoch ein paar Meilensteine vielleicht ganz kurz aufzeigen, die allerdings gar nicht so sehr chronologisch sind, sondern eher medial. Denn Sie werden sehen, dass Anton Corbijn jemand ist, der in den verschiedensten Medien nach und nach tätig geworden ist und dort seinen sehr eigenen individuellen Stil dann eben auch entsprechend ausgeprägt hat. Wenn ich Namen sage wie Tom Waits, die Rolling Stones, U2, Bon Jovi, Frank Sinatra, Bryan Adams, Luciano Pavarotti, Depeche Mode, Joy Division, das sind das erstmal Namen, das sind aber nur ein paar der Namen der Leute, die Anton Corbijn im Laufe seiner Laufbahn fotografiert hat. Und entsprechend hat er auch relativ viele Plattencover gestaltet. Und das sind dann oft auch Platten, die Sie wahrscheinlich alle kennen, die in irgendeiner Weise auch legendär geworden sind. U2 zum Beispiel, The Joshua Tree, Rattle and Hum oder das berühmte Album Achtung Baby. Depeche Mode, Violator, Songs of Faith and Devotion oder Ultra. Von Nick Cave, von den Bee Gees, von Metallica, von Travis oder auch von Herbert Grönemeyer. Er hat aber jenseits der Fotografie oder sozusagen davon ausgehend dann auch Musikvideos gedreht und zwar sehr, sehr viele. Und auch sehr gute, das ist eben auch genau das, was Anton Corbijn für uns auch so interessant gemacht hat, dass er zum Beispiel auch ein legendäres Musikvideo gedreht hat für das Stück Atmosphere von Joy Division. Das war die Wiederveröffentlichung eines Stücks von 1980, wo er 1988 ein sehr einprägsames Musikvideo gedreht hat. Für das Video zu Heartshake Box von Nirvana erhielt er auch 1994 den MTV Award. Und er ist insbesondere diesen beiden Bands, die ich schon erwähnt habe, Depeche Mode und U2, eng verbunden geblieben. Das heißt, er war auch so ein bisschen oder ist ein bisschen der Art Director dieser beiden Bands und hat zum Beispiel für Depeche Mode nicht nur die Musikvideos gedreht, sondern auch in letzter Zeit einige Dokumentationen, also auch Konzertfilme. Und er hat auch die Bühnenbilder für die Tourneen von Depeche Mode geschaffen. Vom Musikvideo ausgehend hat er sich dann weitergearbeitet zum Spielfilm. 2008 hat er seinen ersten Spielfilm vorgestellt, Control. Und der hat nämlich dann auch wieder etwas mit seinen Musikvideos zu tun. Denn in Control wird die Geschichte von Ian Curtis, dem Sänger der Band Joy Division, erzählt. Insofern sehen Sie da also auch den Link. 2010 dann aber The American mit George Clooney und der Musik von Herbert Grönemeyer. Sie sehen also, wie Weggefährten hier sich auch dann durch die verschiedenen Gattungen hindurchziehen. Und zum Abschluss möchte ich Ihnen noch einen Film ans Herz legen, der mich ganz besonders fasziniert hat, weil der meiner Meinung nach noch einmal sehr schön zeigt, wie solche in die breite Öffentlichkeit spielenden Medien wie Plattencover dann in gewisser Weise von Corbijn auch in einem anderen Medium noch einmal bedient wurden. Er hat nämlich 2010 den Smallest Shortest Film gedreht. Das ist ein nur eine Sekunde dauernder Film, der kürzeste vollständige Spielfilm, den es gibt, der gedreht wurde anlässlich des 30. Niederländischen Filmfestivals. Und Corbijn hat dafür 5 Sekunden Film aufgenommen Von denen hat er dann nur ein paar Bilder ausgewählt und die wurden auf eine Briefmarke gebrannt. Und diese Briefmarke hat dann nämlich wie ein Wackelbild funktioniert. Das heißt, die konnten diese Sekunde Film dann eben auf der Briefmarke sehen. Und diese Briefmarke ist erschienen in einer Auflage von 350.000 Stück. Das heißt, da sehen Sie also eben, wie ein Bild in die Öffentlichkeit getragen wird. Und insofern ist das natürlich auch populär und eben auch irgendwo Pop. Und darüber werden wir ja dann auch gleich sprechen. Damit haben wir auch schon die Schlüsselbegriffe mit dem, was ich jetzt aufgezählt habe, was uns heute Abend erwarten wird, eben Sound and Vision. Wir haben das Ganze sehr kühn Pop-Theorie genannt. Diejenigen von Ihnen, die sich einmal mit Pop beschäftigt haben, werden wissen, es gibt nicht die Pop-Theorie, es gibt ganz viele Pop-Theorien. Und ich bin selber jetzt gespannt auf heute Abend, was wir alles im Laufe dieses Gesprächs hören werden. Aber ehe wir das tun, Anton Corbijn, please take the stage. You will do your presentation now and afterwards we will do the dialogue between Robin Curtis and you. Welcome also from the side of the Institute for European Art History, and now I'm leaving. Thank you.
My speech. Thank you very much for the introduction. Yeah, I love this. Sound and vision. There you have it. I thought before we have the conversation, I'll tell you a little bit where I come from, how my work has developed, and why I developed a certain way, maybe. So we already saw this image earlier, but that's where I was born. I was born on an island in Holland, in the 50s, it really felt like an island. Now there's lots of tunnels and you don't notice it anymore, but the sense of isolation was really there. And only recently I actually noticed that the waters around it, well, one is Holland's Deep, which one of my shows is called Holland's Deep, and I'll tell you why, but another piece of the water is called Dirty Hole, and another one is called The Kill. So I think they tried everything to make you not leave the island. By putting scary names on the bits of water around it. But I grew up as a son of a minister. I was the oldest son of a minister in the village. And it was in the days that these small communities were very religious. So I didn't feel that I could really live, although at the age of 10, maybe that's a big word. But then in the mid-60s, on the radio, the Beatles came and music that sounded excited and that always sounded as it came from the other side of the water. And I became very fascinated by that idea that there was people, teenagers, that had an exciting life, and I thought it was like the promised land. So I became very focused on that music. And when I was 11, my parents left the island and we went to a small village but in the bigger part of Holland. And I started to buy records and it became an obsession. And I didn't know what to do anyway with my life, so I was hoping that for some miracle I would be part of that music world. And that miracle happened when we were 17 and we moved again. We moved to a city in the north of Holland called Groningen. And I was also a very shy person in those years. And we moved in the school holiday, so I didn't know anybody there. There was a local band that I liked very much. It was one of my favorite bands from Holland that would play in the town square in the afternoon. And I was so shy, I didn't dare to go there. So I asked my father if I could borrow his camera because I felt that if I carry a camera, people realize why you walk to the stage. Because I think when you're shy, people talk, you think that people talk about you, so I wanted to give myself an excuse for walking to the stage. So since I had my father's camera with me, I took a few pictures, about 9, and once they were developed in the store, I was brave enough to send them to, or stupid enough, I don't know, but to send them to the a magazine at home, the music magazine, and they published 3 of them. Not that I got paid, but it said from one of our readers. And I thought the whole world realized that my pictures were in the magazine. But it showed me that I could be standing near a stage, near the music, and maybe take pictures, and they got published. So I got, for the first time I felt I had a purpose to be near music and make that part of my life. So this was, it's a terrible picture, so I'm just showing you how badly I started. And I started as a fan, you know, there was no higher ambitions. This was in Groningen, it was a Bempel solution. It's a really bad picture, but that's how it started. And then I got very enthusiastic, so I tried every weekend to go to a concert somewhere in the countryside of Groningen, and take pictures, and they would let you, because it was early days. There's a band called Focus, they were very big at some point, but I would just be on stage and take pictures with my father's camera with a flash on it, or would take even pictures in the dressing room and before they go to stage, but I would take just one picture of each. It's terrible, but that's how I started, and it was the biggest band in Holland, Golden Earring. I took two pictures, and it was the best one. So obviously I didn't crop it. This is the negative, just to show you how, you know, where I come from. So initially it was just taking pictures on stage and just before people get on stage with my father's camera. Then the next school holiday I worked in factories and earned my own camera, but I was still very focused on taking pictures, on live pictures, you know, and so I bought a camera with a long lens. At the same time, I started to look around what kind of photography there was, and originally only what kind of music photography existed. And I came across a few really great pictures that influenced me. The first one is by Elliot Landy, of a band called The Band. They were the backing band of Bob Dylan originally, and then they became known as The Band. They're an amazing group, but it's such a simple picture of five people standing in a line in a field. But it's hard to make a better picture of a band, I think. So I've tried to copy it. I'm sure we come across something that looks like it. Then there's Jim Marshall. He was San Francisco based. He was somebody who carried a gun and cocaine and a camera. But he took amazing photographs. This is Janis Joplin. Jim died a few years ago, but there's a documentary made about him that will be released this year. Quite a character. I knew both of these people. This is from Michael Cooper, this is the Rolling Stones, it's Stonehenge. Michael was an English photographer, he was based in London, and he photographed everything that happened, whether it was sit-ins, there was gallery openings, he was friends with John Lennon, he was friends with Mick Jagger. It's a real great documentary guy of that period. Unfortunately, he was very disappointed when the 70s started and he committed suicide. He left a beautiful work behind. And then David Garr, who started out as a folk photographer and then came across Bob Dylan, and then he became a photographer for Columbia Records, who had a lot of great artists at the time. And this is a picture of Patti Smith in the Chelsea Hotel, which I love. And then in Holland, I grew up in Holland, there was a lot of photographers who were very politically engaged, and they would travel the world to the hot spots of revolution and counter-revolution. This was one of the Dutch guys, Koen Wessing. And he printed always, they printed quite hard, and they printed the sky always in to make it more dramatic. And I really like that. So I think I'm quite influenced by the sort of documentary side of photography. I tried to go to art school. I tried to apply for three different art schools in Holland, and I was turned down every time. That has to do a little bit with the period, early to mid-70s, photography was not really seen as an art form, so you always had to get into art college because of painting or drawings, and I was terrible at both. I was not very good at photography either yet, so I then managed to go to a school that had one day of photography a week, and I was given lessons by frustrated photographers. Meanwhile, every evening I would go to a concert and take pictures. I was so keen on making that work. I lived in a brothel at the time. It was not a great time. But in the school, they always had a Dutch photographer called Paul Huff as the example of what you could do. And he did these kind of pictures, just advertising. And for me, it was always like this moment, you know, I don't want that. Then before he died, Paul Huff, he asked five Dutch photographers to photograph him. And I was one of them, and of course I met him then, and he was such a nice man. I was so embarrassed that I always talked bad about him or his work in interviews. This was him. He was also the photographer for KLM, so I photographed him with a plane. And then after he died, there's two awards that were named after him, and I was the recipient of both awards at some point, so he has the last laugh. This is basically my life in photography, so if you just quickly take that in, then we're all good. This is the simpler version of it. So I started on the top with a series called Famous. That's my 70s and 80s, and that's from an outsider. So I was looking in from the inside, then I became more well known and I was able to approach more people. That's a Star Trek period. That's looking in from the inside. Then I did a fake paparazzi series called 33 Still Lives. And it's looking out from the inside, and I did the self-portraits, it's looking out from the outside. And that really in sort of covers what I wanted to do, I think, in photography with musicians. And I've been lost ever since, but still having a good time with the camera. I show you a few pictures through the years. This is one of my oldest pictures that I still like. It's from, I think, from 73, it's Memphis Slim. And I started to knock on people's dressing room doors after a concert or before and ask if I could take a photograph. This is also in the 70s when I lived in Holland, as Rijk Hoeder, leaning on a guitar case. In my photography of musicians, I use instruments rarely, because I found it too predictable. Also, I wanted to photograph musicians as people, and I felt if they have an instrument that they just become a musician. So I tried to avoid that. But I show you one more with an instrument that became quite well known, as Elvis Costello, with a guitar, that became his cover for his autobiography. It was also in the 70s in a tiny hotel room in Amsterdam when he just started. I actually had to stand in the wardrobe with a wide-angle lens. That was how big the room was. And then this is Johnny Rotten in Amsterdam. It starts a little bit, you know, I used to have maybe in the 70s one or two pictures a year that I kind of liked. And this was definitely one of them. And this is another shot in Holland on a railway station with Jack Bruce, from Cream and all that. And this is a picture of Steely Dan in a hotel lobby. The guy in the back is playing piano, killing some beautiful song somewhere. But Steely Dan were not very often photographed, and they loved this picture, so they then told Rolling Stone that they should publish this picture, which Rolling Stone did, so it became my first international kind of photograph. And they used it themselves on the Greatest Hits album, for which they paid me very little, but because I asked very little, I had no idea. But I was so happy. As you can see up to now, I don't use a studio, and I hardly ever have. So walls became my neutral ground. So I became a very good wall spotter. Also, of course, I was just a known photographer in Holland, and I photographed for some music paper in Holland. But you always were given just a few minutes to shoot, you know, because they visited Holland for a day, press, and you had an interviewer, a photographer, so you ended up with a few minutes, so I became very good in using the places where I had to photograph to my own advantage, and you don't need much for that. This was a big Dutch musician called Herman Brood. He was a friend of mine. He loved rock and roll, you know. Unfortunately, that included for him drugs and everything, and burglary and all that, but he was a playboy, but he was a lovely guy. I moved, I photographed sometimes in England for this music magazine in Holland, and I felt every time I went to England that my photography was better, and I always felt that it had to do with the intensity of the people living there, that, you know, choosing to be a musician was not just a luxury choice, it was all or nothing kind of vibe. And I think I always felt attracted to people who, whatever they did, was intense, and they gave it everything, because I was doing that as well with photography. So that, I think, made me veer towards certain people. One of these people, and the reason I moved to England, was a band called Joy Division. I just loved their music, although my English was pretty bad. I didn't know so well what they were singing about, but I could feel it. I took this picture. That was the first picture I took when I moved to England. I managed to persuade him to do a photograph with me on a Sunday morning, because I said I was an important photographer from the Netherlands. And they, after the concert, and they were not very well known yet, so they decided to do a photograph with me. They came to the nearest tube station to where I lived, because I didn't know London yet, and I only knew that tube station. So they came there on a Sunday morning, with the black coats, shivering from the cold. It was November, and I asked them to do a photograph like this, because I felt it was symbolic for the music they made. The album was called Unknown Pleasures, and I felt it was like a trip to Unknown Pleasures. I was so happy with the picture, and I showed it to some magazines, and nobody wanted to publish it, because they didn't see the faces. The only people who actually liked it were Joy Division themselves, and they asked me then to come to Manchester at some point to do more pictures, and this is one of the pictures I did later in Manchester of the singer, who a month later committed suicide, and he became the subject of my first movie in 2006-07. That was Ian Curtis. So, because he killed himself, the other picture, the group shot, suddenly looked like it was a premonition of his death, so everybody then wanted to publish that picture. And it was an interesting example for me how outside factors influence how people look at your work. Obviously, I had no inclination at all of his mindset. Then in the 1980, I became the main photographer for an English music magazine, which was the sort of European kind of heavyweight called the New Music Express, the NME. I was for 5 years the main photographer. There was a weekly magazine, so there was an incredible demand for pictures the whole time, and there were so many shoots. And I loved it, and in 1980 I started to take a lot more pictures that I really liked. This is Captain Beefheart, incredible musician, incredible man. But he was also the subject of my very first short film in 1993 called Some Yo-Yo Stuff. Same year I did David Bowie, when he played the Elephant Man, and I don't have so much time to talk, but there's a funny story with that. There was the next day I met David in a bar, and we played a Frank Sinatra song on the jukebox, I remember. This is a photograph of Ari Up from the Slits with Nina Hagen together, who was pregnant, and I always thought it was quite a beautiful picture. My idea was really that to make pictures that elevated more than just the sum of the parts, you know, and obviously I fail very often, but that's the goal. And that's why I always disliked the term music photographer, because I feel I'm a photographer, portrait photographer probably. But yeah. Another shot, Pete Townsend from The Who in England, Kate Bush. As I was shy, I didn't photograph initially so many women. Also, music was very dominated by men at the time. But there is a sensuality that comes sometimes in the pictures in the 80s. There's Kim Wilde, Mark Almond from Soft Cell, The Cramps, Susie Sue. And this is not the studio, it's my hotel room in Tokyo. So you can see there's a bit in the corner there. I'm not, it was a photo shoot. But I just need to say it's a hotel room, it's not a studio. This is James Brown. This is Sinead O'Connor. I like that out of focus effect, because it gives you a sense that she's threatening you, like you were taking a picture, and this punk suddenly steps in front of the camera. Peter Gabriel, it looks like he's crossing a river, and I felt that was symbolic for his music. Tom Waits, as you expect Tom Waits, I guess, you know, in a car that doesn't ride. Miles Davis, one of my most well-known pictures. Again, it was just a hotel room with daylight, nothing, don't read. The only incredible thing about this is his pupils of his eye. They're so huge. I've never seen that in anybody. And he said that was because he was taking some serum from a goat for his pain. Yeah, it's a picture that's quite often copied. He was a beautiful man, I have to say. I liked him a lot. But it was only a few minutes for the shoot. So then I started doing music videos in 83, 84. Slowly, I became more involved by what happened in front of the camera. As I started more documentary-like, I started to direct more. And you don't notice that initially, but if you look back, you see, oh, that's happening. And there was a picture of Nick Cave, which obviously is not how I find Nick Cave, but obviously I was involved in what you look at. And that was more or less the end of my first period of FAMOS, the black and white pictures. And I then did a self-portrait, my first self-portrait, where I tried to open my thinking frame, which is very literal here, and try to get rid of my ego. That didn't work, but okay, the picture is there. The next period was a period called Star Trek, which is because I wanted to change, because after my first book I felt I had achieved maybe what I thought I was going to be having released when I was 60. So, and I didn't want to repeat myself too much, so I changed camera. I went to a Hasselblad square format. I moved temporarily to Los Angeles to work with different kind of light, and I wanted to shoot more people that I was interested in, more different art disciplines, like actors and directors, not just musicians. So this is Allen Ginsberg at his home. And the significance of that picture is also that Allen, whenever he was home, he took a picture out of that window every day. William Burroughs also at home. There's also significance, of course, with the story with his wife in the shooting thing that he stands next to, not just physically, not just visually, that you have a sort of echo of his body, but when he was in Mexico, he put an apple on his wife's head and shot, but he missed the apple, and he killed his wife. So there's that thing hanging over him over his whole life, and that picture has that. This is Johnny Hooker's hand, Clint Eastwood, Nick Cage, but it's pictures that you don't see everything in the picture. And I think these pictures you can't take anymore. When you were asked for a magazine to do a photograph, they probably hate it when you come back with this, but maybe they hated me too then, but then they didn't say. This is Spielberg. Spielberg you saw in those days always as a dressed up guy at award shows, and I wanted to get a picture where it looked like he was still playful, and as a child I thought he must have played under the sheets with a little torch and do movements with his hands. So he did this, and then on my request, and then a few years later he made Jurassic Park. That's all I'm saying, I never heard from him again. Martin Scorsese, Isabella Rossellini, like an Italian immigrant, and the last series of The Sopranos has a picture of Tony Soprano with the Statue of Liberty, which they asked me to do because of this picture. The only difference was this was taken from Manhattan side, and the Soprano picture had to be taken from the New Jersey side. So you get quite a different picture in the end. There's Gerard Depardieu and Pavarotti, Frank Sinatra. This is a picture of Frank Sinatra, how he would look like a person in one of his own songs rather than the famous Frank Sinatra, again with bow tie and everything, where you see him at concerts. Remained faithful. Here I think it's important to point out, the information you have has a lot to do with how you read a photograph. If I tell you that Marianne and me had a great night together and it was in the morning, this was our breakfast, then you look at the picture different than if you say, well, this was a photo moment, I was with five other photographers, and this was just what we did. No questions. This is Courtney Love, and it's beautiful. wonderful how the water cycles circles around her. It was after Kurt had passed away. Michael Stipe, R.E.M., Van Fresno from Nine Inch Nails. His eyes are painted on his eyes, so you get a, it's a very natural picture. He has a snail on his shoulder, he's naked. He has nature behind him, but I wanted something that was, makes you feel uneasy, and that was that's the eyes. Christy Turlington, Naomi Campbell, Lenny Kravitz, obviously, Mick Jagger. And that's sort of the end of my Star Trek period. I photographed like this a bit longer, but I did a specific paper and a specific development which gives you black and white and brown in the same paper tone. It was not toned afterwards, it was in the development, and it, how you mixed your chemicals determined how it looked, whether it was very heavy or very light. But anyway, nobody puts any money anymore in development of black and white, but this Japanese company whose paper it was from, they did, and they improved the paper, and now you can't do this anymore. So it naturally stopped, you know, for me to take these pictures. Then I did a series in the late 90s called 33 Still Lives, which was a fake documentary series. I wanted to put back some mystery in these photographs, because at that time, Hello magazine and all that stuff came, and there was no mystery left anymore in that world. And I thought, well, people always think I photograph truthful things, so why don't I just lie, and people think it's true. So I did pictures like a paparazzi with a flash camera, and I shot on a Polaroid film, and I made it blue and red, like a movie poster that's been in the sun too long. Usually the blue gets left over, so the little stills also of a movie, non-existing movie. This is Cameron Diaz with Ewan McGregor, and Johnny Depp, Mel Gibson, push-ups. Danny DeVito, as if he's been lifted by a balloon, because that's funny, because we all know that Danny DeVito is quite small, and that makes the picture funny. So your knowledge about what you're looking at helps. De Niro, Lars von Trier. Yeah, it was mid-December, maybe. Kids. Stephen Hawking, because I wanted to show the magic of Stephen Hawking, the mind, rather than a disabled person. So I bought these glasses that are mirrored glasses, and you see my flesh here in there, but it looks like planets. Björk, Nick Cave, who's a regular in my photographs, Kylie Minogue, and Bono, Joni Mitchell, Clint Eastwood, Sophie Zalmani, Catherine Deneuve. This was Willie Nelson. And on this picture, the flash didn't go off. And I was so principled when I made the book that I didn't include him in the book because the flash hadn't gone off. Later, I realized how strong this picture actually is. I was looking at a priest from some movie. Mm. Then I did a series of self-portraits. I went back to the village where I was born because I wanted to find out what had made me so obsessed with music when I was young. I thought maybe there was something in the village that had spurred that on. But as I told you in the beginning, because there was nothing, I got so focused on what was across the water. And then I decided to do a series of pictures of me dressed as musicians who had passed away, but musicians who I had liked. And at the same time, you could see the environment where I grew up in. So I started with the Beatles. This is John Lennon. And it's all done in front of camera. So the noses, the hair, makeup, everything was done in front of camera, not afterwards. That's the church of my father, and this was in the back garden of the house I was born. There was George Harrison, that was in the front of the house where I was born. So the back and round the house is the Beatles. And there's Ian Curtis in the field, and there's this Buckley, could be Jeff or his father, Kurt Cobain, Jimi Hendrix. And you see in the bottom right, you see the sign of the village, the strange still. Elvis Presley, there happened to be a guy who collected a Cadillac on a roof, so it was all in the village still. Freddie Mercury, and behind him is the hairdresser where I used to go, that was still there. Buddy Holly, Janis Joplin, that was more of a test for me. Frank Zappa. I also then did a series in a studio where you could see how obsessed I was to try to look like these people. So it's without the clothes, it's just purely that. And I put all this Frank Zappa again. Then I did a picture of all these faces together, and it's called Heaven. After that, I wasn't sure whether I should do conceptual photography or what, so I went back a bit. I thought, while I'm thinking about it, I keep taking pictures, and I did a lot of painters. A bit more in the old style that I did, my first pictures, but then on a different format. So there's Square, there's Marlene Dumas, there's Luc Tuymans, Lucien Freud, Christopher Ofili, Peter Doig, Richard Prince. Right. Pardon? Jeff Koons. Thank you, Anita. Jeff Koons it is. 2 points. Gerrit Richter. John Baldessari, Anton Kiefer, Damon Hirst, Ai Weiwei, yes, very good, Bryce Marden, Jack Whitten, and I also do some color photography sometimes. It's Herbert Grunemeyer, Michael Stipe, Rutger Hauer, who's a great actor and a friend of mine, David Byrne. I used a lot of Polaroid film that's very grainy. I did it also for self-portraits. Very grainy film. Beautiful, but they don't make it anymore either, of course. Betty Smith, a reference to horses for somebody who pays attention. Peter Gabriel. Then I did pictures with a little torch sometimes because I didn't know what to do with color, and sometimes I didn't know what to do with people. So I made it very graphic. This is U2. It's shot in total darkness, with just a little torchlight, so whatever, you keep the camera open and whatever you touch with your light beam gets on the film. And then I do tricks with it, but it's all done in front of camera. Adam Clayton from U2, as they say, is the largest member of the band. This is Bono, who you see through different phases of my photography career, or not career, but I probably have a career, but I don't mean to say that in my development of my work. There's some people who come back time and time again, Brian Eno, Nick Cave, and Tom Waits. I think I should stop. I used to have some stills from my movies, but that's not important. This is a movie I really loved making, by the way. This is all done in Germany. The most wanted man, Philip Seymour Hoffman, he is by far the best actor. This is Philip Seymour Hoffman with John Le Carré, who's the writer of the book behind him. He had a cameo and asked him to grow a beard, and nobody recognized him, unfortunately, for him. This is my last film about a photographer and a person in the public eye called James Dean. There's just a few stills. And this is just some fashion stuff I'm doing. I'm doing a show called Mood Mode, which the idea is that, you know, we all, whether you wear a black t-shirt or whatever, it's your fashion. Sorry, I'll stop it because it's, I need to talk. Robin, I also do some design, so it's just, you know, I would have liked to have been a painter, so I use paint quite often to make lettering, but that's as close as I get to it. I have one picture at the end, which I'd like to show. Sorry, guys. It's this picture. Because if you don't know what to do, then dress up like the person you photograph. That's me and Bono. Okay, thank you. That's where I am.
I did want to take up some of the comments that were made at the outset, particularly because what I was asked to add here is some kind of thoughts on the way that pop functions. In other words, the way that your work is part and parcel of our time, actually. And the suggestion suggestions that were made at the outset is that these photos work as a canvas. In other words, they produce knowledge. And also, there was an emphasis on sound and vision. In other words, the intermodality of experience, the complexity of sensory experience, that it's not just sound and vision that's at play, or perhaps just vision here, but actually that the senses are called on in a very complex way by all of your work. And so I wanted to think about two questions to begin with, or two overarching questions. What does pop do? I would answer personally, it asks us to reflect, causes reflection. In an older time, one would have said, perhaps contemplate. The other thing that I would say is, how does it do it? It calls our senses in a complex fashion into play. So I wanted to maybe structure our discussion by saying, like offering something like three hypotheses with regards to pop. Because your question to me, Henry, at the outset was like, what's your perspective? What is pop? I would say pop is a place, pop is a time, pop is an artifact. And in thinking about your work, I really, first and foremost, was caused to reflect on the specificity of place, the importance of a certain place for the experience that an article in the context of pop has, and the specific quality of experience that it offers is so dependent on that place. So what I wanted to start off by asking you is, you moved to London in 79, I only misspoke, but you moved to London in 1979, and almost immediately you shot photos of Joy Division, and clearly that was a really pivotal experience for you, not only because you started working with New Music Express and then also a lot with The Face, to totally significant publications for pop music journalism in a period where pop music journalism was completely significant. This is one of the reasons I want to emphasize the specificity of time and place, because this is no longer the case. And what I was thinking about so much looking at your work is how photography lived so strongly from its placement within pop journalism. Music videos lived so strongly from their placement within a certain kind of television experience. In my own life, not in MTV prior to that, in the late 1970s, racing home from school to watch the one show on CBC, the Canadian national television station, where they showed videos, for an hour. And so I was hoping that certain things would come on, and that how your life gets shaped by those things. So my question is, what can you say about London in 1979? How did it affect you?
Well, it was before music videos were shown, in a way. It was before MTV Europe started. But the coming into London and towards Christmas, it was late October 79, all these magical records were released, like the first album by The Specials, London Calling by The Clash. It was wild and wonderful be in the midst of all this, and I'm meeting Joy Division and meeting Joe Jackson, and I was living a dream in that sense. You know, I couldn't believe that they liked my pictures. I couldn't believe that they were published, and that I became the main photographer of this magazine within a few months' time. And of course, now when you look back, you realize you contributed to how people experienced music. Back. And that's wonderful, but maybe that's not what you're thinking when you make these things. That's quite interesting. I don't think I could have done a better picture of Joy Division if I tried, but it was the only thing I could do, because I could only think of that little place to take a picture. And that's how these things get shaped. I think it's wonderful that you find yourself in a position where you might have contributed to somebody's pleasure in listening and then looking at the picture and connect the dots.
At the same time, though, when you connect the dots between the different objects that you've created over time, and say you look at the photograph that you just showed us of Joy Division in the tube station, And then reflect on that while you're watching Control, your first film, your first feature film. You have to think so much about place in the sense of what's it like to live in Manchester in 1979? What are the apartments like? What's it like to be in a car without heating? Mm-hmm. And what's life like? What's the life at that moment feel like?
Yeah. Well, you know, I had no money myself in those days. So I was living in a basement, and I was kicked out after 6 months and lived in a squat in Dalston with no hot water and a bathhouse around the corner. So I experienced part of that, and for the enemy, I had to go quite often to the north, to Liverpool or Manchester, and with the train, and you would see all the back of the houses when you enter these cities, and it was dirt poor. You know, if you come from Holland, where it's a bit more equal, I would say, living conditions for people. It wasn't the case when you went to the north of England, or the middle of England even. And that was quite a shock for me. I felt like I was in a third world country. So I felt all that, and that went back into the film. Actually, we didn't shoot in Manchester for the film, but in Nottingham, because Manchester wouldn't let us shoot us there. But Macclesfield, we used a real house and all that stuff, so we got very close to how it was, I think.
One of the other things that struck me really strongly about Control is the very first scene of the film. And I'm sorry I'm making reference to films that you didn't see in screenings before we started today, but I urge you to try to see all of the films that have been mentioned here. The very first scene in Control, Ian Anderson, it's hilarious, Ian Curtis.
Strange last name.
Sorry. Ian Curtis returns home with an album under his arm and lies down on his bed and starts listening to David Bowie's Pinups, but in a very typical pose for you know, a young person, and that's why I emphasize the role of reflection in music. This is the thing that sets the stage for the film. Can you speak something a bit more about your experience of music, not only as a photographer, but as a point of reflection as a young person growing up in Holland?
Yeah, you know, I think I had a very low self-esteem, so I didn't know what to do with my life till I found photography and music. But just the fact alone that you like music of a band called Joy Division so much, although you don't understand it totally because you don't understand the lyrics, that you moved to England. You know, nowadays, I don't think people would do that so quickly. But music was a center place for people. It was the center of their lives. You know, and you talking about going home to watch things on television. You know, you stayed home for Thriller or whatever. Michael Jackson would be shown on the BBC at 9 o'clock. You'd be home, and so it determined much more how you lived, and your focus was there. Yeah, you know, I mean, living in a brothel or in a squat, I did all that to be part of that music world, of that, have that experience with my camera. Nowadays, I guess your energy would in other things, you know, because there is so much other stuff to focus on as a kid, as a teenager.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm thinking about. One of the parallels that occurred to me thinking, sitting here, particularly because this is hosted by like an art historical institute, is the way in which pop cultural items in some ways get removed from their use context in much the same way that art historical objects were removed from their use context. In other words, paintings were in churches and had a particular function within the liturgy or within the practice, within certain spaces, and then once they become art objects, they're placed in museums and are removed from practice. And I think there's some of that here as well, especially once you think about them in the digital age. In other words, when they're accessible everywhere, the photos are no longer anchored in music journalism, in the context of music journalism, with the excitement that comes because you're waiting for the next week's New Music Express to appear, or the next month's face, and you pore over the pages of the magazine, and you appreciate its materiality, the beauty of the photographs. It's an entirely different experience because of the practice that's demanded through analog forms that all of these things used to take.
Yeah. I think context is a big thing here. And I, when I did all these things, I didn't think any further than being in the next issue of The Enemy, and that was its context, the music magazines, or maybe a record cover. I never thought of hanging it on a wall in a gallery or museum, and that's what it has become now. So it's cut off in a way from the direct source, but it was meant for. But of course, obviously, I'm happy about it that it can live its own life. You know? And I have to say, there were some pictures in the 70s that I showed that I always felt like I would still like them in 10 years' time. That they were not depending on the popularity of a certain song. I always try to avoid that. One of the reasons I started doing music videos is that there were so many beautiful songs and they had really terrible videos. And I felt like, how can you do that? How can you let that happen to your song? I always wanted to be my photograph to be seeing eye to eye to the people that was taken off. And so then I started doing music videos out of a sort of anger of what was there. And I don't think I was very good initially, but I managed to make it a language I could speak.
Can I also ask maybe about the faces of the people you're shooting? In the still photography, it's clear it's portraiture. You're entirely interested in the contours of the face, exactly the way it looks. In music videos, the faces have a different kind of role. In other words, music videos are working in the context of an industry and have a certain job to do. And for that reason, I wonder about your relationship with notions of celebrity and also the way that celebrity has changed over the last 30 years. One of the things that I found striking in going back to the music videos that you've made is how regular so many celebrities who were pop stars looked. They look like a bunch of guys, okay? You can put them in a certain context and they become familiar guys. They maybe are the guys that are on your bedroom wall. Of course, you know, there's of course fandom. Nonetheless, they still are a bunch of guys. And part of the process of you know, producing videos is to somehow transform that, but not entirely. It's not entirely like the influencer of today. It's something else. How do you view celebrity, or what was your approach to that in photographing, but also in producing video?
I think in photographing, initially was in awe, and that's not a good place to be when you work with them. So you want to see people in the eye. I managed to do that at some point. But with the film thing, you know, I didn't do any big films. You know, I did something for Art of Noise, for Trevor Horn, and then I did something for a German band called Palais Chambord, and it was, in my experience, there was not a lot of people seeing these things, you know, so I think I was allowed a lot of freedom, and the budgets were minimal. With Depeche Mode, for some reason, they let us do our thing. You know, I just came up with an idea, and they, okay, and I shot it Super 8, I could shoot it myself. They were very small affairs. They became very meaningful after a while, these videos, but when we made them, they didn't feel like they had that much significance, but it was fun. And I very rarely had people perform the song. I always had a little story, and the band were actors in it. And I was lucky with Dave Gahan from the Depeche that he's a pretty good actor. So that helped me getting these stories on film. I think I'm a little lost now in your question, where your question was.
It's about celebrity, but I can add something to it. One of the things that made me think a lot about celebrity is watching your films as well in relation to your work on video. If you watch all of the feature films that Antoine Corbijn has made, there's a really interesting way in which you start to realize that they're often about people who want to disappear. That there's, in other words, a very wanted man life. Those are two films definitely where a lot of the characters in the film seek to not be visible, seek to be self-effacing. And in life, it's a lot more pointed because it's about James Dean. And there's a real dilemma there about presenting an image and somehow disappearing oneself, saving something perhaps, but appearing and disappearing at the same time. And in some ways I felt like your film work, Ian Curtis, much the same way. Your film work comments in many respects visually on that process.
I think that's kind of true, yeah. It's loners, I think, kind of thing. In the music videos, I sometimes use humor. It's very easy to use humor in music videos. In my photography, that's not so apparent. But the music videos that came out in my films, it doesn't really, but that's just different. The idea that you're in the end on your own, I think is something that I think about a lot, yeah.
And also simply that it's not always possible to live with what the demands are from the industry that you're working within. And I felt like both of those films, in other words, the industry in the one case, A Very Wanted Man is about, you could say international espionage, you could say the long arm of the State Department in the United States. In other words, people who work for their governments in a way that, where they want to not be visible. Where James Dean seems to be an entirely different issue. Nonetheless, the real dilemma faced by those people in their chosen professions is such a feature of both of those films. I found it extremely interesting that this is what you're personally reflecting on in your work most recently.
Yeah.
Yes.
No comment.
Maybe let me ask you something else. The film that you've most recently worked it's a film that's going to be shown on Arte in the next week or so. I think on the 25th of January is the screening on Arte, and it's a film of a concert of Depeche Mode in Berlin in 2018, but on the other hand, and perhaps most interestingly, it's about a group of fans of Depeche Mode and the way in which Depeche Mode plays a role in their lives. In other words, it's about fandom and the practice of fandom and the significance of it too. It doesn't make fun of any of the protagonists at all. How did you get involved with that project, and how did it develop into so strongly an examination of fans?
Yeah, well, there's two things. I'm officially the visual artistic director of Depeche Mode. I'm involved in almost everything. I also design the stages and stuff. But because I design the stages, I like them to film it. So I have a document of it. So I'm pushing all this for it. But should we not make a live film? And they said, well, we've done so many, we shouldn't really. Then the management really said, well, why don't we do something about the fans? Now, there is a movie about the fans with Depeche Mode. It's called 101, they're 30 years old. This is great, it's American fans, they travel to the gig, but it's a bit one-dimensional. So during the last tour, they had a Facebook page, and you were allowed as a fan to be the owner of that page for a day, but you had to give Depeche Mode a good reason why you should be that person. So all these thousands of Depeche Mode fans wrote in with their stories why Depeche was so meaningful to them and why they should be the owner of that page for one day. And out of that whole selection of people, we started to search and try to get people with different cultures, different backgrounds, different stories, and also geographically in different places, to come to a group of six people. Then I didn't film these people, but I was overseeing the whole thing. And then we integrated it with the music. So it's about, I would say, 65% it's fans and 35% music. And it worked really well, and it's a very different film in the end than 101. But the bands have a really interesting fan base, and in a way it's a cult band, but the biggest cult band in the world, really. And the fans, they buy tickets for 10 shows. It's unbelievable. Anyway, that's that story. But I don't call that, it's not a feature film for me. It's just a sort of, yeah, live film kind of thing. But I was going to do a feature film called Devil in the Grove, but it was dropped in September. In September, yeah, I worked on it for 4 years on getting the script right and all that. We had a lot of problems with it. The producer died, but it's a fantastic story about racism. Unfortunately, the winds in the industry have changed to a degree where I can't no longer be the director, but I hope somebody will make it at some point.
It's kind of interesting also to consider the way in which control plays a part in various media. In other words, we were speaking about this beforehand, that the work on feature films or even large-scale documentaries like the most recent film is an entirely different kind of work from photography. And again, a different kind of work again from working on music videos, which have clear, you know, they're clear Auftraggeber. There are people who are hiring you for a certain purpose. And it's not like producing perhaps for the art world, which might be slightly different. But have you left producing music videos entirely?
Yeah, kind of. I did bits and pieces the last 5 years, but. Not much. I don't get excited about it anymore, really. And you know, you make a video, and it's just I don't know where it goes anymore. But it was interesting, the difference between making films, which is I find far more challenging, and a place where I want to go to, is that the music videos, you know, you have a great song, and you have to put some visuals to go with it. You know, they can go anywhere. These visuals that. You know, even if you make bad visuals, if the song is great, it will be fine. But if you make a film, you know, you notice that films are not very strong. They use music really loud in order to create some excitement. But the real challenge with filmmaking is that you make a great film and then you add the sound to it and the music. It's the other way around, and it's far more interesting to me how that goes.
One other thing I wanted to mention with regards to the Depeche Mode film, which I found really striking, and also which I find striking about your career in general, is it's often argued that popular culture is a force of globalization. In other words, things become more uniform throughout the world. We all hear the same music. It's all in English. That kind of argument's made. And one could also make the argument that popular culture specifies and supports the local. In other words, there are very strong local influences at work within popular culture. And one of the things that I found interesting about your career is that you're not only working with English-speaking musicians, in other words, musicians working only within like an Anglo-Saxon recording context, obviously, how about Grünemeyer, but several others as well, including also Dutch artists, but not only. And that's not always the case. The other thing that I found really interesting about the most recent film is the way in which it emphasizes there are certain things that are indeed globally offered, but what's made out of those objects is local. In other words, the woman in Siberia is distinct from the man in Colombia, and he's distinct in his biography from the man in Romania, and they all listen to Depeche Mode, but under entirely different circumstances and to very different ends, and Depeche Mode meant very different things in those places and was differently accessible.
No, that's really interesting, because it's a communal thing, this music goes out there, but you want to make it a singular experience when you listen to it, and that's how I also look at my photographs. You know, I want it to be a singular experience. It's my experience. It's my little story, whereas it is a communal or global experience where it starts with, but then you make it individual.
Yeah, in a hugely specific way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What for me, sometimes when I see the photographs, is meaningful too, because as you know, I'm not a studio photographer, so I go to where people are, And so my journey to meet these people, for me, is wonderful. You don't know where you end up, and it's just great experience. It's something you can't tell in the pictures, but for me, that's always there as well around it. You know, that's what I quite like about looking at some of the pictures, that the story of how I made it comes back to me.
Can I ask you one other question, maybe about the aesthetics of the music videos that you made over the years? One thing I found really striking, that's not only true about the music videos, it's also true about your photography, is that often, but especially in the music videos, you're working with Super 8 or, I don't know, 16 millimeter. In other words, one thing that's apparent in the finished product is that the grain of the image is highly visible, which isn't necessarily the way that you go if you're interested in offering sort of a fashion photography look. You know, it's a very particular look, and that's also often the case in your portrait photography, that there's, you know, large grain or, you know, blocks of color. How do you continue working that way, or is movement into film a problem?
Well, to a degree, you know, I think it comes from the fact that I was always very uneasy with beauty, and I was more into it. So I found it hard to work with beauty, and I tried to make people look interesting rather than beautiful. So all these things helped me to make them look interesting. And I wanted pictures also to look like they were documentary, I guess. So the graininess gives you a feeling that it's a stolen moment from something. It doesn't feel it's so set up.
That's funny.
In stills.
In videos, it's quite striking, just because you have to, again, think about the context in which you see music videos. Obviously, it's a potpourri, right? What comes next? Who knows? It's you know, this video, then that video. And so the next video might be shot on, you know, 35 millimeter film. And
yeah, or an iPhone.
Yeah. It's true too.
Yeah, well, I remember when we did Control, I did some tests because we wanted to shoot it in black and white, and the black and white film was so grainy that it was annoying. You looked at the grain moving all over the place, and it's like, you know, that's not really what I want for my first film. So I shot it in the end in color, knowing I was going to make it black and white. So how we designed rooms and all that stuff, we kept in mind always it was going to be black and white. So I think that's why it looks like a real original black and white film. It was not an afterthought, putting it in black and white. But the grain became annoying.
It seems like the grain has become less an issue in the most recent films, or in the narrative films, in any case.
Well, now when I shoot more digitals for stills for the last 1.5 years, obviously you want to make it look like film, because film is the most beautiful thing. It's like, you know, CDs, you know, it's terrible sound if you listen to vinyl. But we always throw the good things away and then want to make it look like that again or sound like it again. So I put grain quite often in the mix again to give it something that I like.
I don't know, you have to stop me whenever we have to stop.
I'd say we take another question and then we open up to the audience.
Okay, I did have one other question though, and that is, one of the things I found really striking again about comparing your work as a portrait photographer and the films you've chosen to make, because, you know, a film, it's hard to make. It's really a labor of love. You don't just make a film for the heck of it. And is that they're so focused on landscape that they're really, really interested oftentimes in placing the characters in a very specific landscape, whether it's the landscape of Hamburg or the landscape of Abruzzo in The American, which is so detailed. And the human figures are almost obfuscated by the landscape, which is completely the opposite of what your obviously portrait photography is doing, and you don't seem to have worked very much on photography in the same way.
No, perhaps because in film you can then go closer again. You have that because it keeps going in a, if you do one picture and you get someone to be very far away, that's it, you know. So I do feel that in photography I work with architecture and nature quite a bit, you know. even if it's just a wall, you know, it has to be a good wall. But in the two films you mentioned, it's interesting, both The American and The Most Wanted Man, I took the guy who wrote the script to those places before he wrote it. And I said, I want this to be a character in the film, the landscape from Abruzzo in the city of Hamburg. It was written by an Australian guy, Most Wanted Man, and who lived in Australia on a farm, so he rode horses, but I took him on a bicycle in Hamburg, and he couldn't sit anymore at the end of the day, because he'd done so much, he was standing on his bicycle, because he was not used to it, but anyway, so that was a great way to see a city on a bicycle. And the beauty from Hamburg was that it's not in that, it doesn't appear as a city in many movies, so it's nice because you see a lot of things for the first time when you watch the film.
Yeah, we would open now to the audience. I just throw in a question I was asking myself all the time. Do you still watch music videos yourself?
No, I don't, but I don't watch TV much. You know, so it, no, I mean, if somebody tells me they made a great video, I will look at it. Mm-hmm. But I don't search for any music videos at all. No. I feel that's something I've done, and I like to continue, and that's also why I don't do a lot of new bands, because I feel I've done that when I was young, and I want my life to have a lot of different experiences.
So, if you want to ask questions to Anton Corbijn or Robin Curtis, there's a microphone standing over there, so you feel free, invited to ask a question. Und Sie können natürlich auch Fragen auf Deutsch stellen, wir übersetzen die dann, also keine Scheu, bitte, daran soll es nicht scheitern. Bitte.
Oder Holländisch. Ja, auch gut. Was that a question? Or a monologue? But I think that you know, what I do with photography or film, it's very much how I see that those people or that music, and I want to make it interesting for myself, and then I hope that it's shared, you know. You can't sort of guess what the general public will think of what you're doing, you know, because I don't want to be led that way. And the few times I've done it that way, I was usually, I think, disappointed with what I did. Does it answer it a bit? Yeah, okay. Oh, sure, you know, I mean, I'm you're only as good as your last edit, you know. So, yes, of course, there are things that you don't like as much, and I had an exhibition called 1, 2, 3, 4. It came about when I was 60, and where I live in The Hague, there were two museums next to each other, and they both wanted to have a show of my work. And I promised the one museum to have my work, and the other said, "Well, we like it as well." And I said, "Well, all my work is in this museum. I don't have anything anymore." But then I went through all my stuff, all my contact sheets, for a couple of months every evening while I was editing a movie in Berlin. And it was difficult, because you're looking at sometimes months of work where you think you didn't make anything beautiful or useful, or you know, I was wondering what I was thinking when I was making it, till you find the one picture that you forgot you made, and it's like, oh, great, you know, that I at least got that back. But I felt something desperate that I felt had thrown away a lot of years. You know, it's difficult. Sorry, there you are. It's difficult. Yeah, you fail. Obviously, you fail. You know. I'm sure. Yeah, I mean, I made a video that never saw the light of day for the Chili Peppers, and you know, yes, yeah, of course, yeah. But similarly, I sometimes said yes to people. I do the picture, and then I thought, what have I started? I don't find any connection here, you know. Because I know you mentioned John Bon Jovi. You know, I don't feel connected, you know, but I still did it. And that's harder for me. You know. I realize that if your enthusiasm or love for something comes natural, you're better, you know, in what you make. You know, it's a mix. You know, I'm more playful than I appear. Let's put it that way. I think that showing the real person, I'm not sure if I'm able to do that, and it sounds boring to me. So I think it's a mix quite often. But usually, these people are so good in what they do, they're not normal in that sense. They have something special, and I like to play with that. You know. So there was something in the beginning that you said, which I thought I'll answer that, but it's gone. What did you say? How did you start it again? Sometimes, I guess I'm definitely part of marketing, but if you look at the photographs that I showed, I don't think you can tell for which pictures I've been paid and which pictures I want to do for myself. It is my photograph, and no matter what the conditions are of the you know, if it's for marketing or if it's for myself, it still will be my picture.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff happening, but it's definitely a different world than when I started. You know, everybody for starters is a photographer now, and so we're getting very confused into the importance of photography, of a certain image, which doesn't help in a way. And then you need to put yourself out there, otherwise your photography is not seen. You know, magazines lose their importance. They don't pay anymore. So it's a dying industry. And people put their pictures on social media to get other people to see it, at least. You know, I'm on Instagram because you need to be on Instagram as a photographer. And I started 3 years ago, and I have to be reminded myself sometimes to put something on it. I'm also on Facebook, but I'm leaving Facebook because I don't see any place for that anymore, and I don't like how Facebook goes about your data. Unfortunately, they also on Instagram, so you can't get away from it. But yeah, no, it is so different now, and what to do with your work, how do you want your work to be seen? And obviously an artist wants to be in control of what they make. You know, that's what you really want, and it's hard, and sometimes you just have to let go. You put something there and just let it be. The only way you can be in total control is if you publish a book or if you make a show. You know, but then it'd be more limit the amount of people you can reach. So it, yeah. I don't think so myself. And also, I think I wouldn't be tempted to do what I did nowadays. You know, I think my pictures wouldn't be liked by magazines. What I did in the old days. I think people like it now because it's, in a way, a document of a very important time, and nobody did what I did. So there is a huge collection of images of people that people are now interested in. But I think if I was unknown and I started to do pictures for a magazine, I think I might have a hard time. I don't know. No, I think personally I was uncomfortable with beauty, because I think it has to do with your own self-reflection, with how you look at yourself. But I was uncomfortable with that, so I didn't know how to create it. And when there was like some of the models that are very beautiful, I never knew what to add to that, because I thought, you know, the beauty is already there. What is my significance here? You know, I don't know what to do with it. So it took me a long time before I started photographing really beautiful women. Yeah, that's really interesting. You know, because some friends of mine, they just keep the finger on the shutter and then basically make a film, and then later they take the pictures out of it. Which I guess is a way to get an image, but I don't feel it's photography anymore. Now, we don't have to be very principled about it, but I take more pictures than I used to. Because especially with the Hasselblad, you have 12 frames, and you have to put another film in, and it slows it down. But it's more satisfying, I think, with a film, because you don't know what you get exactly, and there's a nice tension between the moment you shoot and days later when you see contact sheets. But it's one of the reasons why I was against digital for a long time. I thought it influences your result, you know, because you keep looking and you want to go to perfection, whereas I think imperfection in a way is far more interesting. I shoot digital because sometimes I need to deliver very soon, because magazines especially expect you to shoot digital, so their deadlines are so short now. It's really difficult to shoot film. The expenses of film are very high. There's no money anymore. But I mean, you can choose to pay it yourself, of course. But the other one that I do like about digital is that you can shoot in almost no light, you know, when it's really dark. With digital, you can get an image, which is amazing. It sees everything. What I've come to love is the digital post-production. It's the best dark room you never had. You know, you can do anything. But I do that when I shoot negatives. I scan the negatives, and then so the post-production is digital. I don't print anymore by hand. Well, I mean, I was young. So, you know, you have tunnel vision in a way. I wouldn't like to go through it again, but I didn't also not know what else to do with my life. And I guess I found it exciting enough to continue, you know. But it is hard work. You have to have discipline. You have to have luck, you know. But you also have to recognize your luck, of course, to play with that. But. Yeah, no, I don't want to, you know, I consider myself very fortunate, so I don't want to bring a hard luck story here. It is hard work, but, you know, I love what I'm doing, so it's easier to take when you like what you're doing. And yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Probably. Yeah, probably. You know, what I usually do, I give people a selection of images and they can then select from that what they want to use. Yeah. I'm hopeless. I only, because I'm doing a book now, so I'm actually dealing with an issue. There's only about 6 people in a book of 180 that I asked for permission, because I signed something at some point. You know. For the rest, you ask people an opinion, they will have it. And I'm not interested.
Okay.
It's basically the answer.
So don't ask.
Yeah, exactly.
Ganz herzlichen Dank an Robin Curtis und an Anton Corbijn. Und